ministered for your joy and blessing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Our guest preacher is the Reverend Dr. C. Diane Mosby.
Yes.
The planner and senior pastor of the Anointed Life Baptist Church in Henrico, Virginia. Dr. Mosby is a prolific preacher and teacher, expanding her ministry just not here in America, but internationally as well. She serves her community in several organizations addressing mental health, wounded warriors, counseling services, and religious affiliates.
Thank you.
She is married to Jeffrey A. Mosby Sr. of Glen Allen, Virginia, and they have 3 adult children and 9 grandchildren.
Yeah!
Dr. Mosby, welcome, and we wish to see Jesus. After the musical offering of the Friendship Music Ministry, hear the word coming from a God's virtuous woman living in this virtual reality.
Thank you. I recommend you, God. International Day. I thank God for traveling mercies this morning. I thank God for those who have traveled with me, my armor bearers, my deacons, and my deacon trainer, and my husband. Amen. I bring you greetings all in virtual land and all who are here assembled this morning from the Anointed New Life Baptist Church over in Henrico County. Amen. We love you, friendship. We are honored to be in your presence here. Your wonderful pastor and first lady, I want to thank them for the invite, and also want to thank them for their love and friendship. It means something to have friends in ministry. Everybody is not your friend. You might have some colleagues, and then you might have some folk who are on assignment for some other stuff, but everybody is not your friend. And so I thank you all once again for the privilege. Look, I'm not going to hold you long. There is a word from the Lord. I want to be faithful to our time, and I want to be faithful to our God. And so if you would turn with me to your focus scripture this morning in Titus chapter 2, beginning in verse 11, Titus chapter 2, beginning in verse 11, I want to read out of the Good News Translation those first four chapters out of chapter 2, beginning in verse 11 down through verse 15 out of the Good News Translation. And it is recorded this way: for God has revealed his grace for the salvation of all people. That grace instructs us to give up ungodly living and worldly passions and to live self-control, upright, and godly lives in this world as we wait for the blessed day we hope for, when the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ will appear.
Yes.
He gave himself for us to rescue us from all wickedness and to make us pure people who belong to him alone and are eager to do good. Teach these things and use your full authority as you encourage and rebuke your hearers. Let none of them look down on you. Let none of them look down on you.
Amen.
Today I want to use as a subject, despised but not deterred.
Right.
Despised but not deterred. Released in November 2019 and then showing again in movie theaters all over the country free of charge for Black History Month was the movie Harriet. Some of you may have even went to see it. This extraordinary film chronicled the life of Harriet Tubman and her escape from slavery to become one of America's greatest heroes, whose courage and ingenuity and tenacity freed hundreds of enslaved people and changed the course of history. Tubman is perhaps the most well-known of all the Underground Railroad's conductors. During a 10-year span, she made 19 trips into the South and escorted over 300 of the enslaved to freedom. And as she once proudly pointed out to Frederick Douglass, in all of her journeys, she never lost a single passenger. She became known as Moses because she delivered her people out of bondage. She was quoted as saying, "Don't you tell me what I can't do. I made it this far on my own. God was watching, but my feet was my own." Running and bleeding and climbing and nearly drowning. Nothing to eat for days and days. But guess what, family? She made it. So she keeps telling her folks, she said, "Don't you tell me what I can't do. You don't know me." Irrespective of what she was called, regardless of those who refused to help, no matter how many folks wanted to look down on her, Harriet was determined to go on. Time and time again, she was despised, but she refused to be deterred. And here is where we find the early church, as Paul is writing to Titus in this brief, poignant letter. Titus was a Gentile that was converted to Christianity. Can we say he was already a target? Oh, y'all ain't with me yet? He was a young leader who had been charged to supervise the work in the early church in Crete. Oh, y'all missed it again. And Titus, being young and a leader in the church, found out that opposition was now his middle name. Paul gets wind of some of the conflict and potential discord, and he writes this letter to Titus to tell him, "Hey, bro, I heard that you've been going through. The word on the street is that the people aren't trying to hear what you got to say or follow where you're trying to lead. But let me encourage you. You might be despised, but don't you dare get deterred." And this is our message for the morning, ladies. As you celebrate International Women's Day, as you rally around your theme, a virtuous woman living in a virtual reality, I'm here to remind you about our assignment for the kingdom of God. And you see, we all have a purpose, and we all have been called, and we all have been given a charge to keep us, keep our impact for the kingdom of God alive right here and right now in the earth. And sometimes, like Titus, our very presence will make people uncomfortable. Oh, I wish I had some folks I was preaching to this morning. Sometimes our own presence will make them uncomfortable. You might be wondering why, because we represent change to the current order. See, Titus was very present to the people, and because he was, it messed some folk up, because Titus represented change. Change how they live, change how they function in the church, change how they treated each other, change in their behaviors. Titus represented change. And like Titus, sometimes our assignments seem overwhelming. Sometimes the folks that we are called to lead, direct, or influence just aren't trying to hear anything you got to say. Can I say this morning that it can be frustrating to try to fulfill an assignment from God that sometimes doesn't even make sense to you? Yeah. Oh, I wish I had somebody. Yeah. All you know is God said go. All you know is God said go and do it. All you know is God said show up. God said lead my people out of slavery, Harry. God said help my people through the virtual reality friendship. And before you know it, you've been thrust into leading something that you thought was just a passion. Oh, yeah. You're leading, and you didn't even know anybody was following. Lord, I wish I had five real folk in here this morning who could declare leading is always what is cracked up to me. My God. Look, most people didn't like change. They don't like change. They don't like having their status quo shaken up. They don't like shifting their norm or finding a better way. They don't like dealing with the uncomfortableness of growth. Therefore, you become the target of their saltiness. Not the issue, not the need, not the outcome, but you. Yes. You become the target of their saltiness because you represent different. You represent the chaos on the way to things getting back in order. You. So how do you stay the course in the midst of being despised, in the midst of being dissuaded, in the midst of being dejected? How do you keep from being deterred on your assignment? Well, my God, I believe I got some folk in here who want to know, because it's right there in the text, right in verse 11. It reminds us not to discount grace. Amen. That's what it said. Did you see it? Look at it again. For God has revealed his grace for the salvation of the people. Friendship based on this text. Can we all agree that God has revealed his grace? Yeah. To all of us who have been saved, and to all who are going to be saved, and those who get to experience God's grace, because God's grace is sufficient. Can we agree right there this morning? In other words, God has shown the saved and the unsaved a measure of his unmerited favor. That means that sometimes the blessings of God rain on the just and the unjust. You see, so often we think the grace of God, we associate it with justice and mercy, right? Justice is getting what we deserve, and mercy is not getting what we should deserve, and grace is getting the good that we do not deserve. But can I push this thing a little further this morning? Can I push it? Grace is not just for us to be spared from death.
Amen.
Even though I'm grateful for eternal life, but right here, right now, we get to experience God's unmerited favor that we did not earn.
Yeah.
And we do not get to dictate who God's favor falls on. Oh, I wish I had some folk this morning. Listen, if grace is favor, unmerited favor, that I cannot earn, but that God graciously gives as he pleases, then it's up to God how he dispenses it and how he gives it out. And so that helps me this morning, because now I can understand how in the midst of being despised, I don't have to be deterred.
Yeah.
Oh, I wish I could catch that. I wish I could get you to catch it. Look, Harriet didn't make 300 trips back and forth on her own. But the grace of God shined favor over her.
Yeah.
And placed folks along the way to help her. Oh, my God. And folks that hid her. Folks that opened doors for her.
Yeah.
Folks that provided for her. And all of them, y'all, were not saved. Oh, I wish that. All of them were not even for her cause. And can I say it? All of them were not even on her team.
Yeah.
But sometimes, in God's infinite wisdom, he'll cause your enemies to help you and to bless you. Listen, you are sitting right on the job right now, not because you were qualified, but because God's favor opened up a door for you.
Yeah.
Somebody else was plotting and scheming and smoothing up to the boss. They knew they were in. They knew they had it. They knew they had it right in the midst of everything. And all of a sudden, God shined the favor on you.
Yeah.
And now here you sit where they wanted to sit. And they hot as fire. But don't you miss it. Favor ain't fair. Someone else in here got raised while other folks were being escorted out the door. Not because you deserved it, but because God's grace favored you. Somebody else saw the judge rule in your favor, my God. And you knew you were guilty. Guilty, I tell you, guilty. But God favored you and spared you. And the justice that you should have got went on past you. Because God favors you. God's grace ushers us into his unmerited favor, and then causes other folk to release what they have in their hand to bless you. For the work of God and for the work of the kingdom, so that you can go do what God has assigned for you to do. The word says God reveals his grace so that the people can see salvation. Woo! In other words, family, this is not about you, but it is for you.
Yes,
look, can I just go ahead and try to make it plain?
Amen.
See, God releases his grace upon folk like you and me.
Yes.
So his salvation can be seen.
Yes.
Salvation. Y'all know salvation, right? A way out.
Yes.
Salvation, a better way.
Yes.
Salvation, a hope in darkness.
Yes.
Salvation, deliverance.
Yes.
Salvation, water in dry places.
Yes.
Salvation,
yes,
the renewal of dry bones.
Yes.
I'm talking about salvation this morning. Anybody know about salvation? That God uses you so other folk can see salvation.
Yeah.
They can see a way out. They can see that God is able. They can see that God showed up. They can see that if he did it for you, he'll do it for me. Salvation is what I'm talking about this morning. God uses you that other folk might see his salvation. So how can we make it, y'all? How can we make it in the midst of being despised? I stop by to let you know this morning, don't you discount God's grace or his unmerited favor in your life. But listen, y'all, listen. Can we keep hope alive?
Yeah.
Can we keep hope? That's the next point. Can we keep hope alive? You see, too often when we have been called out, assigned, and commissioned, we begin to strategize.
Uh-huh.
I know I ain't going to win. I know. It's human nature. It really is. From the pulpit to the door, we start thinking about how we're going to make this thing work, right? You know, especially if you're like me, a planner, a visionary, and, you know, a borderline type A.
Yeah.
Oh, y'all got no type A folks in here? Okay. Well, you know, Jeff may not agree that I'm borderline. He might say I'm too far to the right end of my type A tendency. But I think y'all get the picture, right? And so oftentimes I find myself guilty of looking at to self.
Yeah, I know you're right.
I get the plan, and the first thing I do is looking at me. Well, what do I need to do? Well, how do I need to fix it? Well, how do I need to plan it? Well, who I need to call? Well, what I need to do? And before I know it, I missed the trust in God part. Ooh, Dr. Cousin, I wish I was preaching to some real folks this morning. You know, I missed the trust in God part. You know, sometimes, you know, we look at self quicker than we look at God. Oh, I wish I could say that, you know, immediately I always trust God first. But that's not always the case. Now, I eventually get around to it. After I put my foot in it and mess it up all the time. After I'm trying to plan it and ain't nothing coming together and I'm wondering what's going on and how come it ain't working right. Well, the Lord said if you'd have called on me first, we would have already been 10 miles down the road. He said, you still stuck on mile number one. But sometimes we get it mixed up and we turn it around. But family, when we do that, you know, you got to put you first, then we fail to keep hope alive. That's what we do. You see, I know the biblical definition of hope is tied into our faith as the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen, right? But can I push again a little further this morning? You see, if I say and believe that my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, that I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but to hold and lean on Jesus' name, on Christ, the solid rock I stand, that all other ground is sinking sand, then keeping hope alive has nothing to do with us, but all to do with the one who's already given us the victory.
Thank you, Lord.
So when I keep hope alive, I'm actually keeping the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus in full view. Oh, I wish you could catch it. Therefore, my job on this journey is to help folks see Christ. Not me, not through me, but Christ. In my conduct, in my living, in my serving, in my interactions, in my leading, in my negotiating, in my home, in my marriage, in my children, in my relationship. I keep hope alive when I keep Jesus alive. And I keep Jesus before the people because he's the one who paid the price for me. And that's who's given me victory and rescues me from all my wickedness. He's the one who keeps me pure in my thoughts and in my deeds. He's the one who keeps me eager to do this work when I'm weary and I'm worn out. He is the one who constantly shows me the example of how to live in this crazy world and not lose my ever-loving mind. He gives me hope that a better day is coming. So did you see it in the text, family? Did you see it? It's right there in verse 12. It tells us that grace instructs us on how to live as we wait for the day when our Savior will appear. So we can take heart, family, because while we wait, we can also attest that Jesus came, Jesus bled, Jesus died, and Jesus rose from the grave. And he also rescued us from all of our wickedness. And he made sure that we were pure. And he made us righteous. And he made us holy so that we could do the work that we've been called to do. So when the hellhounds are on your heels trying to get you to give up and throw in the towel, when the spirit of discouragement wants to keep you depressed and sleeping, when the spirit of weariness wants to tell you it's not worth it, that you'll never finish, that you'll never be successful, that you will never graduate, that you'll never pass the test, that you'll never get the degree, that we'll never see equality, that we'll never experience justice or make a difference, that's when we got to keep hope alive. We have to look at hope. We got to listen to hope. We got to live for hope and see that hope has already given us victory over all the wickedness that will try to come up against us and try to take us out. Harriet said it. She said, God was watching, but my feet was my own. In other words, family, come on. God is watching, but we still got to keep moving. We got to keep pressing, and we got to keep going, and we got to keep believing that change for us is possible.
Yeah, yeah.
We got to believe it, family. And that's how we can press through being despised and not deterred. We must keep hope alive. Hope in Jesus Christ. Hope alive. Hope in his life. Hope in his death. Hope in his resurrection. Hope in the victory he gave us. We got to keep hope alive. Stop telling folks to follow you. Stop telling folks to look at you and let them look at Christ. Point them to the one who's already given us the righteousness. But Jesus' blood and righteousness. And I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but holy lean on Jesus' name. But look, and then finally in the text really is simple. He said, we must teach.
That's it.
Right there. It's in verse 15.
Oh, you're helping.
Paul admonished Titus to teach the folk.
Teach.
Right there. Teach the folk about God. Teach the folk about faith and the faith we profess.
Hallelujah.
Teach them about Christ. Teach them about sound doctrine and Christian conduct. Teach them about unity and community.
Yes.
Teach them about justice and equality.
Yes.
Teach them about martyrs that paved the way for you and me to be here today. Teach them about Christ and that they can be saved. And we've got to teach y'all in the dark and dismal days that we are dealing with right now, we must teach.
Yes.
We got to teach our children and our children's children about our Savior that made salvation possible for all of us. But we can't stop there, family. We've got to teach them about the transatlantic slave trades. And we got to teach them that we didn't come here as slaves. Oh, somebody help me preach this morning. We came here as kings and queens and princes and princesses and mathematicians and doctors and skilled craftsmen and dignitaries. And just because we were enslaved, we don't have to settle for systemic bondage. We got to teach about the Jim Crow era and the lynchings and the white and color water fountains and the injustices we have endured. We have to teach them. We got to teach them about the water hoses and the dogs that may be a thing of the past, but the threat and intimidation of insurrection on the nation's capital and the nooses still exist today. We got to teach them that Jim Crow laws is a no, but suffering and equal is still a yes, Lord.
Yes.
We got to teach them that segregation is a no, but the have and the have not is still a yes. We got to teach them that Governor George Wallace is a no, but racial profiling and unjust sentencing is still a yes. But here is the hope, family. Paul told Titus, and when you preach, and when you teach, let nobody look down on you. Oh, I wish I had a witness. I wish I had a witness this morning. And I stopped by this morning to remind all of us that when we find ourselves in places where folk want to discount you, where folks want to dissuade you, where folks want to despise you and look down on you, hold on. Hold on. God said, be not deterred. And don't you dare turn back. Hold on. The work that I have begun in you, I will bring it to completion. Hold on. It ain't over till God says it's over. Hold on. The race is not given to the swift, but those who will endure till the end. Hold on. My grace is sufficient for you and your weakness. Hold on. We may endure through the night, but joy will come in the morning. Hold on. I stopped by to tell somebody this morning, you need to hold on. God ain't finished with us yet. Hold on. We shall see the salvation of the Lord. Hold on. Family, we got work to do. And we must stand up for change and continue to do what is right in the eyes of our God. People are dying in our streets. People are cold and homeless and discarded. We got work to do. Folk can't afford housing because they can't even earn a living wage. We got work to do. Seniors can't get fair medical treatment or affordable medication. We got work to do. Our children are often being taught in substandard conditions. We got work to do. And Harriet Tubman told Frederick Douglass, in all of her journey, she never lost a single passenger. So I stopped by to ask us this morning, can we say the same? In all of our journey, in all of our journey, have we lost a single passenger? In all of our journey, can look like to me, we lose some folk every day. So even though we may be despised, we cannot afford to be deterred. Y'all hear me this morning? We can't afford to give up. We can't afford were depending on us. Big Mama done did their part. We standing on their shoulders. We sitting up in this beautiful sanctuary because they gave. They gave out of their widow's mite. They gave because sometimes they didn't have it to give. But they love the Lord and they love the institution of the church and they love their community. And they did what they needed to do to make sure we didn't lose a single passenger. Family? My virtuous sisters? My God, my God, my God. Living in this virtual reality. Hold on. We can make it through this. Who would have thought March of 2021 would have been a year? When we first got started, we were trying to figure out how in the world we were going to make it 30 days. We were trying to figure out how in the world we were going to shift and pivot on a dime. Get our services online and be able to stay connected to one another and be able to still do community efforts and continue to connect. And but we were clueless. But guess what? We stayed. We made it through all the unjust ways that the African American community have been treated in COVID. We still here. So I just stop by to tell you today, don't get discouraged. Don't get hold on. We might be despised, but we shall not be deterred. We have work to do. God bless you, Christian. Don't you dare be deterred. Don't you dare turn around. I don't care how many folk don't like change. Change is evident. Change is always evident. But we can't give up. God bless you.
Thank you, Dr. Mosby, sharing your word today with us at Friendship as we celebrate International Women's Day. To our viewing audience, we pray that God's love has been a blessing to you through our time of praise and worship on International Women's Day. If you do not have a meaningful relationship with Christ, please say to yourself, I accept the hope that is in Jesus Christ to be my Lord and Savior. As I turn from my way of living to follow the Savior's guidance, if you have made this confession or are looking for a church home, please contact us through our social media outlets, and we will be glad to help you be a part of the family of God. If this service has been a blessing to you, please consider donating a love offering to us through our GiveFly online service for Friendship Baptist Church in Hopewell, Virginia. May God's peace keep us. May God's faith grow deeper. May your love spread wider. May God's peace keep us for all the hope of his Son. Amen. Please join us next Sunday for another experience of praise and worship from the Friendship Baptist Church of Hopewell, Virginia. We love you right